Broadcasting live from the Norman P. Murray Community Center in the heart of Mission Viejo, celebrating their 25th anniversary this year, it's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, featuring special guest Brian Simpson.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly here on FM 88.5 KSBR. Glad you're here. It's a big President's Day weekend, and of course, you know what that means. That can only mean one thing on President's Day. That means all of our mattresses are priced to move right now. I don't know why did they do that? Kelly is not here. Deanna Millay is here, and we're thrilled to have her joining us this morning. But better than that, we've got this gentleman right here who's going to be lighting this place up this morning. Please welcome Brian Simpson. Everybody, we got them all hour long. Stick around here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. We'll be right back. Nice.
I love freaking men out. I love it. These two men are freaking out. I'm over here letting our guests know I have actually been looking at his profile on Facebook, and I have a couple of great questions for him.
That's creepy. It's an internet stalker. I like that.
Uh-huh,
you need that.
Yeah.
See, I'm hoping someday to have a stalker, Brian. That's when I'll know I've arrived.
Can I just warm up with you first, Gary?
Whatever you want to do.
Work our way into that.
Exactly. How are you, man? Thanks for being here. This is not an easy thing for you to work this into your schedule.
I know. It was kind of last minute, and I'm leaving tomorrow for Dubai. And for the jazz festival there, and from there I will leave for Jakarta, Indonesia, for the Java Jazz Festival.
Oh, you're going right from Dubai?
Yeah, from Dubai there. Yeah. Well, I'm already halfway across the world. Actually, this trip will take me around the globe completely in 2 weeks.
Isn't that crazy?
That's awesome.
Isn't that crazy?
Is your suitcase big enough? Can I get in?
Yeah.
Freaking me out again.
Okay. Is that just like tiresome now, or is that still?
No, it's always exciting, and you know, I've been going to Indonesia for over at least 20 years now, and
I'm, do you get a chance to do stuff
from
there?
Yeah. I'm very good friends with the promoter, so
yeah.
Sometimes they've organized trips for me to go to Bali after like do a show and then stay at a nice villa there and do so. Yeah, we it's plus getting to play for other people in other cultures. It's great experience, and there's audiences there are so good. 50,000 people a day go through the festival in Jakarta. 50,000
really?
A day. That's a 3-day jazz festival. Yeah, it's
where do they
pretty
have
amazing.
It?
It's at a big expo center, a big, huge convention center in the city. It's one of the most populated countries in the world. So
yeah, isn't that crazy?
That's crazy.
And it's just amazing to know that far away from here, I've got fans. And
yeah.
So it's fun to know your music touches people.
For sure.
Everywhere.
I'm a fan and I'm a stalker.
There you go. Could you have even imagined that when you were starting off to do this?
Not at all. You know, the first time it happened for me was when I first moved to Los Angeles in the late 80s. I had the opportunity to work on a song, write a song. It became a big pop hit in R&B and pop music. People don't remember the name. It was called The First Time. The band was called Surface. They forget all that until they hear the song. They're like, oh, I remember that song. But it was such a big hit that some of my friends would say, I met with my daughter's song at their high school prom. It was like people got married to that song. They had kids to that song. And to know that, and it was right around the time of the end of Desert Storm, so people, it was a very emotional time. People
right.
come home, and the song was kind of a love song. So it was, to see the impact that just one, the stroke of the pen, writing the song, playing, recording, on a CD, goes out there into the world and on the radio waves, and then people start, an aspect of music I never even thought about when I was studying music was that you're actually going to affect people emotionally, and it's the greatest feeling to find out that affects them in such a great way,
I'll bet. I'd like to, we were laughing about, arc welders and stuff, but they don't get that, I mean, it's crazy. Tell me about your family. You do have music in your family in the background, right?
Yeah, well, I consider myself very fortunate. Both my mom and dad had what I consider very good taste in music, so it wasn't always jazz, but whether it was country music or anything, or pop music, it was always considered good by my standards. My dad had a very critical ear for music, and even with jazz musicians, he would tell me why he liked a certain solo or the way a certain musician played his solos and connected his phrases, which was a sophisticated way of thinking about jazz. I mean,
yeah.
He wasn't a great musician. He played a little guitar, but I would say he had a very critical ear, and it taught me to have that, and I was always... That's something that was always in my mind, is like my phrasing, and it was always a very important thing to me, and it taught me to listen to music very critically in jazz. And I tell young musicians now, there's a lot of people who practice, but you've got to listen. At some point, you've got to listen to, whether you're trying to be a jazz musician or any kind of musician, you've got to find the best in your craft and find someone that you kind of can relate to musically and really, really listen hard, because they're probably doing something that you're not even aware of. And I listened for years, just letting it soak in as a teenager. I couldn't possibly play. I loved Oscar Peterson, who was one of the greatest piano players I ever lived.
Yeah, for sure.
Now,
technically, could never match that, but in my ears. At least that was going through my mind all the time, that kind of
thing. Yeah.
Now, you said the L word, listen. When you heard yourself for the first time on the radio, what was your expression? What were you doing? What exactly were you doing when you first heard yourself on the radio?
Well, for myself, a song that was featuring myself, it was a song called It's All Good, which I was,
exactly.
Yeah, thank you. Well, that was the one, you know, because I'd had a career in jazz already, been around for a long time, playing with a lot of artists. I've watched the beginning of careers of people like Norman Brown and Boney James. I knew all those guys when they were still playing little clubs in L.A.
Yeah.
And but I've kind of watched and helped all my friends, you know, get into the business. And then I was still not making my first CD. And then I had the opportunity through my friend Dave Koz. Anybody remember that guy?
Yeah, we've heard of that guy. Yeah.
But he started a label for a few years. And I was one of the first records they put out. And It's All Good was like the last song I wrote for the record. And it was just kind of like, let's throw this thing on there. And they loved it. And it went to radio. And they loved it. And it was so thrilling. But, I mean, I felt great about the song. Yeah, but it was just like finally some validation. Yeah, I really felt great about having it. To hear it on radio. I can't remember where I was, honestly. But I heard it a lot.
That's great.
And it's awesome. You know, I just love it.
And
I still
Janet
like hearing
Jackson,
my song.
How was that, collaborating with Janet Jackson?
Well, I was in her band for an international tour we did back in 1995. And it was awesome. I mean, 3 months out of the country on tour with Janet. And
Was that a full-on audition deal to get that thing?
That was an audition. Back in those days, there was a lot of auditions for band. I can remember auditioning for Paula Abdul, which I didn't get. But those auditions were rigged. I found it later. But and I didn't initially get the gig with Janet. And it was actually got called back like a year later. You know,
really?
So after they had already been on the road. But it was an awesome experience. I mean, to play in front of, first time I played in front of that many people, I guess, probably, you know, 10 to 15,000 people a night. And we started in Australia.
Wow.
I mean, the audience was louder than the band. And the noise from the audience, from people screaming, it was
that's gotta
really
be nuts.
Unique.
That's got to be nuts.
Yeah,
I've talked, one of those great stories that I love hearing is from our friend Max Bennett, talks about playing, you know, the LA Express with Joni at Wembley in front of like 100,000. You know, it's just, you just can't fathom that.
Well, at some point, the difference between 10,000 and 200,000 is just kind of moot, you know. It's really just, you just see it. You can only see so far.
Because
I've done some of those 200,000 things venues as well, and it's just like you can't even comprehend how many people you're playing for at that point. It's just like you just kind of see the front row, and that's all you concern yourself with. Yeah.
What was the one live gig like that, or maybe it was Janet if that was one of the first ones, but where you went, oh my God, what in the heck?
No, that was my very when I first moved to when I moved. You know, I graduated from Northern Illinois University. I had a little degree in music and came out to L.A. and I'm gonna.
Was that
see
an
what
applause
happens.
For Northern Illinois University? I think it was. All right. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. But I came out to L.A. and literally at the bottom rung of the ladder, I didn't know anybody. I was looking in, back then it was before the internet, so we had the recycler, was a paper that people would put their want ads in. It was
God.
Like Craigslist. It was
funny.
Before the Craigslist, too. And there would be music, there'd be want ads, and it wanted a keyboard player, R&B band, rock band, whatever. So I was like, I want to be in an R&B band, you know? So I was looking at these band lists, and most of them were just wedding bands or horrible. I went on auditions. The bands were incredibly bad. But I would dutifully carry my keyboard and a couple of speakers and set up. And I mean, a couple times I would walk by, and the band would already be rehearsing, right? And I'd just walk by, I'm not even going in there. Like, forget these guys.
There's that listening thing again.
But, you know, I made one connection through one of those bands. There was a bass player that's gone on. Named Smitty Smith that now he's toured with a lot of people. He plays with Boney James right now. But I met him. He was also brand new in L.A. So it's just, you never know who you're going to meet or how you're going to meet them like that. But that was a start. And through a few months of, you know, just trying to do any kind of gig I could, I had a chance to meet a guy that actually was a professional touring drummer. And he got me an audition with Tina Marie. Mm-hmm. And so I got that audition, and our very first gig was at an arena. It was in Oakland. And we also played the Shrine, I think, an auditorium here.
Oh, okay.
And it was for probably 15,000 people or something, like our first gig, because it was a super festival, so it was like us, and L.A. and Babyface had a group called The Deal.
Oh,
Freddie Jackson, remember him?
Yeah, sure.
Gladys Knight, Earth, Wind & Fire. And this was all one show, so it was a lot of people came to these shows. And I was actually freaking out before the show, thinking, am I going to get nervous and just freeze? Because I couldn't comprehend it. Most I'd played for was in, like, you know, a Chicago wedding. I was in an Italian wedding band in Chicago.
So when did it actually hit you that I finally made it? When did it hit you?
Well, it was it. To get on stage in a big venue like that and that many people. And I didn't freak out, and I was able to get through the gig. It's been doing it ever since, you know. It's a wonderful way to make a living.
Yeah, no doubt.
Awesome.
Yeah. No doubt. Good for you. Awesome. What do your folks think?
They've been very proud of me, and you know, I had a kind of dad that was tough to get a lot of, you know, I'm proud of you out of him. I guess, like a lot of people, you're always trying to do something to please your folks or your
no
dad
doubt.
Or something. So
no doubt,
I know a lot of that, but I definitely get it from him now, and they've been so supportive. I would not be here without their support.
Yeah.
I mean, for so many years, they really stuck by me, because there's been ups and downs through the whole process.
Yeah, that's awesome.
A good childhood memory when it comes to music. Is there one that just sticks out like a sore thumb?
Well, I had a love-hate relationship with my teacher.
Oh, I
had
that.
He was a family friend, but he's one of those slightly abusive family friend. So, you know, it's like...
Family friend.
No,
right.
This would be a good story.
I'm not freaking you out again, am I?
No. He was this amazing jazz musician. He happened to be a friend of my dad's. He was a jazz guitarist and piano player, and he was my piano teacher. And what was great about him is that he would take me to his concerts. He would be doing gigs in Chicago, and I could see these pros. Matter of fact, he used to play with artists that would come in. They used to have the Playboy clubs.
There was one
in Chicago.
Yeah.
There was one in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. It wasn't far from my house. So he took me as a 16-year-old boy to get to see Playboy bunnies at a jazz club.
Oh,
I was like,
my God.
This is a life for me.
So
that was the good part. I got to watch him.
You know what Playboy was at age 16, ladies and gentlemen.
But the bad part was the lessons, because he would put his hand on my head, and if I hit a mistake, it was like
really?
He was a big kid, big guy.
This guy was a mobster, wasn't he?
He was a cool guy, and he taught me a lot. Taught me a lot about the business too.
How funny!
That is
how
great.
How funny! A 16-year-old kid in the Playboy Club.
Yeah,
there you go.
And there's more to that story.
No, there isn't. But I have a picture of myself in my little suit, and I had the biggest smile on my face.
Go figure. You had to get attention from the staff, I would imagine, as a young kid.
Yeah, it's all. Well, I don't.
Easter's coming up. We got to get you some bunny ears and send him a picture
of it and make
him smile.
Oh God, help me. Oh man, I don't know
You're
about that.
You're turning red on me. Come on.
I don't
on.
Know about that. I know. You are. You're overdue for some new music here, man. You know that.
What are you trying to say?
I'm trying to
you're
say
you're sick of the old
CD.
One. That's what you're saying.
No. This is a great CD.
And I've been working away on a new one, and I just got the final mixes like 2 days ago. And
that's awesome.
I'm so excited. I was trying to finish this up before I left on my big overseas trip, and I did. And you're going to hear a new song on the radio like next week.
This is all happening
very quickly. Yeah.
Very nice.
This company doesn't fool around.
So the
CD will be in the stores and online in just I think a month or so.
Very nice. Very nice. Brian Simpson is our guest. We're going to. You going to play? You going to play a little something for us there again?
Sure.
Good.
I think
why
so.
Why don't we do that?
If my band is still here.
Yeah, we got that darn piano. We might as well put it to use. Brian Simpson is going to play for us. We'll take a break and come back here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Brian Simpson, this is always a good sign when a guy like Brian Simpson is sitting at your piano. It's certainly a better sign than when I'm sitting at the damn piano. I'll tell you that right now. What do you, as long as you're there, they got a camera right there. Let's see. How's it going? what are you going to play? I'll shut up now. What are you going to play, man?
I can't tell you why. No, I can't tell you why.
There isn't a straight man in the house. It's Brian Simpson, everybody. like our piano, huh? Oh, man, that's awesome. That sounds great. Good stuff, good stuff. You got it working. How about another one? What do you got? Can you tell me this one?
I don't just do funky music. You know, I have a romantic side as well. I love doing this song. It's called Let's Get Close, and I just find that it really connects with people, and I tell them that it's a great song. You get the CD and you go home and you go straight to this one, which is track number 4, even if you're by yourself.
I need a tissue.
Glass of wine.
Let's hear it. Thank you. Brian Simpson, everybody. We're going to take another break, and we'll be back with some more. Brian Simpson, we're on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. Really good stuff, man. Beautiful. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Brian Simpson, our guest. Norm is cracking the whip over there. KSBR's Rob Ballinger. He's very strict as a floor manager. You need that. Just you should write that down, Brian.
Write what down?
My phone number.
Never. Oh, yeah.
You're a married woman.
I am, but you know, you had me at hello. I cannot help it. Music is just a universal language.
There it is. That is really, that really was nice stuff.
Thank you.
Tell me what some of these guys that you've worked with, you know, have brought to your music. I mean, and I'm thinking certainly like Dave, who you've been with for so long.
Well, I will say it's because I've spent a lot of time working as a sideman and get a chance to watch the guys work up front. First of all, one of the biggest opportunities I had was working with George Duke for many, many years, 10 years. And he's an icon, a legend, all that stuff. And
a wonderful guy, too.
Yeah, he was great for me because I met him. I was still in my late 20s, and I consider him a mentor. I mean, I've seen him work under all kinds of conditions, playing all kinds of music with a lot of different artists and dealing with personalities, because it's something that I do a lot now because I'm often music director in a lot of situations. So I learned a lot from George on handling people. And when you're dealing with artists, they have feelings and egos and all that stuff. And it's delicate when you're on a stage and you've got, or take the cruise, for example. I'm the music director for a lot of people. It involves a cruise with maybe 15 artists. And we all got to work together.
Explain, just if somebody doesn't understand fully, what a music director's role is in...
Well, it's not always the same. In my situation, it's usually I'm responsible for hiring a band, and then I have to get music from an artist that they want to do in their show and have to get it to the musicians, and they have to learn the music, and I want to make sure all that happens and make sure that the artist is happy, ultimately, and because ultimately it's about the audience and that they need to be entertained. They want a great show, and it all works together because the artist has to be happy to be able to perform.
Sure.
So it's there's more to it than just the music, you know. That's like, so I know the musicians' personalities very well, and that's why I'm very careful about who I hire, especially when you get on a cruise ship, because you're stuck
to hide.
There. Yeah, as you see how long it takes to get back.
Yeah, right. Oh my God.
So, what is your example of a great show?
Well, you know, even if I've seen musicians feel like come off stage like, oh, I sucked, that was terrible, but then people are coming up to you like, that was the greatest thing I ever saw. That's all that matters, where the people enjoyed the show, and I don't get too caught up, because you're going to have good shows, bad shows, and it happens to everybody, and I don't beat up on other musicians, I don't beat up on myself. If something goes wrong, it's like, hey, it just happens.
Yeah,
as long as the audience was really happy, and you, I mean, I tell musicians, you know, smile, look like you're having fun while you're up here, because there's worse ways to make a living, you know, and I have more people come up to me after the show and say, you guys look like you're having so much fun. And they feed off of that, and we feed off the audience. So even if it's not fun, make it look fun. If you hate this song, play it like you mean it. You
know? So, I know a surgeon like that once. Yeah. You know, I try to have fun. So who are the guys that blow you away? That, you know, I mean, you know,
I got to tell you, you mentioned Dave Kaz, and you know, I take him for granted because we've been friends for over like 15 years now. And, you know, I hear him all the time. I've worked with him for years. I know the sound well.
Yeah.
But he just came and played on the new CD I'm putting out. He came and played on a song. I won't even tell you what it is yet because it's kind of cool.
Which, you said your CD's out next week, correct?
Well, the single's out next week. The CD as a whole thing will be out the end of April, I believe. But Dave came into my studio and played, and it was just heavenly. I was like, and I record a lot of saxophone players. I've worked with any number of them, all the great ones you could think of. I've definitely been on stage with them. and he still blows me away. The guy just has the sound, and his is such a freaking pro. You know, yeah. I don't know what to say. And yeah, just working with him in the band, he just is a I don't know if he's a workaholic, but I mean his attention to detail is like no one I've ever worked with.
Yeah, I believe it, and I think that comes through in everything he does, because it's beyond just the music. I mean, the stuff, you know, when he emceed the Smooth Jazz Awards years ago, and I mean, it's just, you know, you can't do it better than that.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, he's an amazing guy.
Yeah,
he's an amazing guy.
It's a tough act to follow.
Yeah.
but I love, and then on top of it, he's just a wonderful person.
Yeah,
he's a great guy, very generous. Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm thinking about playing. I mean, somebody like Duke, or somebody like that. Is there somebody, how did he do that? Where did that, you know? I mean, are there, you know, a lot of people like that?
You say there are a lot of people.
No, that you just go, oh, my God, where did that come from?
Yeah. You know, well, you know, they're out there, and I meet musicians all the time. We just had a young man on a cruise that Marcus Miller brought on. He's in his 20s, mid-20s, saxophone player, Alex Hahn. And, yeah, you guys saw him. And he was amazing. I mean, and because I'm often asking myself, because I get a little frustrated. I'm like, where's the new George Benson? Where's the new Dave Koz or Rick Braun or whatever? Yeah. I'm just not hearing these guys. And then I see like this kid that is like, he's got the traditional jazz as well behind him. It's like under his belt in a major way. I'm like thoroughly impressed. So they're out there. You just gotta gotta look.
How has the technology, I mean, you talked about being out here pounding the pavement, you know, before the internet was even around, but how has all of that and the ability to do that stuff in your home and your bedroom, you know, around the globe, you know, people scattered all over the place and emailing song parts back and forth, is that good or bad?
Like
or?
A lot of technology, it's double-edged sword, and, it kind of decimated the record business, for sure.
Yeah.
And there's no getting around it, and it's too late now, so we got to stop crying about it and just keep making music. And then, of course, the fun thing is that you can literally see on YouTube or whatever that, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of people are getting to see you all around a planet that would never get an opportunity to even know who you were. And once again, it's nice to know people are affected by your music in a positive way. But And the great thing is, like you said, with the internet, I can, Mark Antoine, you know, played on my new record, and he can record in Spain and email it to me, and, you know, that stuff is pretty cool.
It is.
But it's mostly in a bad way.
Yeah,
unfortunately, because the monetary loss is huge.
Oh, it's insane. But would you have preferred, I mean, it sounds like at least part of this new effort was done individually and, you know, kind of collected electronically and then assembled, or you know, instead of everybody getting down and sitting in a studio together and playing.
Yeah, I've always worked well. Just we call it doing an overdub, where just one musician comes into the studio. I will just do drums one day, another day a bass player will come over and they'll just be working on bass, and I can just concentrate on what he's doing. I mean, it's for my music it works better, but there's other records where you really would want a band together collectively, but at the same time, when you do it that way, you can't get the same attention to detail that you can when you just have one musician one at a time, and you can be telling them, no, don't play that note, play this note. So you know, when you got a whole band there, you can't get as detail oriented with each musician. They just kind of got to take what they play and then, you know, like it.
Question is, a current artist, somebody that you can collaborate with today. I mean, I don't want, there's so many current artists, but anybody specifically, Grammy winner, just currently at the Grammys, anyone?
You mean that I like working with or have or want to work with?
That you have not worked with yet, that you would love to work with.
Well, it's funny you mentioned, I mean, honestly, my musical icon that's still alive today is George Benson. I just absolutely love
George
him.
George Benson's incredible.
I mean, He's the last of a breed of a musician of that ability. And this is a guy, and people always ask me, do you think it's important to read music, not read music? And I definitely recommend learning to read music, but there's a guy that does not read music, and he's an incredible musician. I mean, they don't get any better. That's what I love about him. So.
Yeah, Paul Brown was out here and told us about, you know,
seeing him.
It really is spooky. I mean, that's, boy, if you don't believe in God before you hear that, you know, I mean, it's nuts. Tell us about the new CD. Who else is on this thing? Can you spill some secrets?
Well, Mark Antoine, I mentioned, who's a dear friend of mine. You know he's French. I still like him. And he's
nice.
Well, no, he's, you know, he's very French.
He is very French.
A lot of people are like, I don't know about that Marc Antoine, because he's very French. I mean, you're going to get a lot of, he has a lot of attitude. There's no doubt about it. Not everybody can deal with it, but I can. I love Mark, and he definitely keeps it real. But we do a lot of shows together, and we have shows coming up this year, as a matter of fact. And we just, I don't know what it is, because his style is completely different than mine. It's more Latin and gypsy guitar, and I'm more R&B and this piano, but we just connect as friends, and musically we have a ball, and I love playing his music more than anyone else's music.
Yeah.
Because it's so different from mine, and I love doing shows with him. We just have so much fun. That's my favorite guy to work with.
There
right
you
now.
Go. There you go.
Yeah. Are there any juicy stories behind any of your new tracks on your new CD that you can tell us about? Any juicy story behind a track there?
Juicy story. Well, let's see about the new. I have to think who's on it now. Wait a minute. We got Dave Koz, Marc Antoine, and Elon Trotman, who's another young guy,
yeah.
New guy. I think you know. He's been
absolutely really good. Really good.
He lives in Boston, and I love Elon. Originally from Barbados.
Yeah.
And one of those new guys that has a lot of guys. My problem is they all sound like they're trying to sound like Sam Bourne or sound like Koz or sound like somebody else. He has a completely unique sound, and I like that about him playing tenor sax.
Yeah.
And he did an awesome job. As a matter of fact, I think the song he played on is going to be the first single.
Oh, good.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Good.
So,
very nice.
Really proud of him.
Another guy who I know you've worked with and who is an amazing talent and has a really, really amazing story is Jonathan Butler.
Oh, he's on my new CD as well.
Oh, well, there you go.
Jonathan, I'm trying to rack my brain.
Yeah, no,
Jonathan and Gerald Albright are both on it. No slouches. No slouches.
Yeah.
Jonathan and I, we go way back. I knew him when he was still living in London, and I met him through George Duke, and we spent years together. The first time I went to South Africa was in his band, and this is like over 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And what an amazing talent. That's one musician
he
I
really
can
is.
Say, once again, that doesn't read music, completely just natural musician. There isn't anything that comes out of him vocally or with his hands on an instrument that isn't in time and in tune. I've never met anyone quite like that. I mean, you'd have to, you know, kick him while he's playing to get a mistake out of the guy, because it's kind of freakish, you know. You just kind of.
Did you ever try that?
Once again, I
tried.
I
was going to ask him that too. Have you ever tried getting a mistake?
I'd be slowed down with that. Exactly.
Maybe I'll try it once. I love him. He's a crazy person too. I love Jonathan.
Yeah, his story is just. Ugh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Phenomenal. Phenomenal. Yeah. The. Oh God! What was I totally flaked now. Where I was going to go with that? But he is crazy. And but who else? I'm thinking. Oh, Larry Carlson too is another guy. Who's
yeah. Well, I remember. Well, I had a chance to do a tour once with. Let's see. It was Larry Carlson, Stanley Clark, Billy Cobham on drums, and Najee on saxophone. And when you break it down, it's a kind of a weird lineup though, because. You know, Najee, his style of music, and then Billy Cobham with the jazz fusion, and Stanley Clark is more jazz fusion, and Larry with now playing more blues. And so it was an odd mixture of guys, and I kind of came into that thing. It was a month-long tour. It was a little intimidating. I'd never worked with Billy Cobham up to that point. It was a legendary or jazz drummer, or jazz fusion drummer. But it was quite thrilling. We played at the Greek. We finished up at the Greek Theater in Hollywood, and it was an awesome time. But no, I mean, if I never did another gig, I could say I've worked with the greatest. I've played in the most amazing venues and seen it all.
Yeah, you mentioned the stuff that you've got coming up all around the globe. Can you give a little more detail on that too?
Okay, well, we leave for Dubai tomorrow. Then
me
and myself and I.
Okay,
and
there we go.
I talk about myself.
Yeah.
And then to Jakarta. Then in May, beginning of May, I go to Mallorca for a jazz festival there. That's off the coast of Spain. I know, it sucks, right? And then
no doubt.
Then in July to London for a week there. Me and Dave Koz are going to go play with at this little jazz club there called Pizza Express, which I love playing there. It's right in Soho. And I know that sucks too. And then I know I'm going somewhere else. I can't even remember where it is.
Yeah.
But
you said Bali.
You get the idea.
Oh, yeah, but I don't know if I'm going this year.
Japan
oh, in
right, right,
October,
right.
Tokyo.
All right. All right, we're going to get another song out of you, all right?
Really?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, all right. We're going to take a break. Brian Simpson, play again. We'll be back for our breakfast with Gary and Kelly. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. This is Brian Simpson, and he's good news. He's back at the piano. And what are we going to hear, man?
Well, you know what? I'm going to do the song that put me on the map.
There you go, baby.
This is It's All Good.
Very nice. Brian Simpson. Brian Simpson, everybody. Thank you so much, man. Really appreciate it. Really appreciate it. Watch for the new CD. Brian Simpson, thanks again.
from Saddleback College's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. That was music from Greg Vail, our pal Greg Vail. You got to love, who doesn't love Greg Vail? Everybody loves Greg Vail, right? Exactly. The tune Just to See Her from his Emotion release. We're running so late. It's unbelievable. A little before 11 o'clock, Breakfast with Gary and Kelly from the Norman P. Murray Community and Senior Center here in Mission Viejo. Ladies and gentlemen, Kelly isn't here. Normally, this is the part where she does something really unnatural with food, but filling in now to do something equally unnatural with food, we hope, is the beautiful and talented Deanna Mollet, ladies and gentlemen. And if you've ever, you're Deanna, you're Mollet, what does that mean? I love that name. It sounds like a French car.
Actually,
Olé, Mollet. Nice. All right. What are we doing? We have a thing. We have a hot thing here. This is scaring me. What are we doing?
We do have a hot thing here. That's you.
No, stop that. No, we don't.
To cook
exactly. Exactly. That's what we did. Right. Who wants that egg now? Fine. All right. What are we doing?
Well, actually, after Valentine's Day, we all want to all of a sudden jump on the healthy wagon. Am I correct or not?
Not so much, but go ahead.
Well, you know, here's a quick, easy recipe for all of you out there who actually want to keep an eye on your weight and actually want to eat healthy, which I'd rather have a donut, but you know what?
I'm all about that, as we can tell. Go ahead.
It's all about the egg white with cilantro and onion, where cilantro actually burns a lot of toxins out of your body. So we definitely want to do that on a day-to-day basis. So cilantro with onion and with a little bit of tomato on it actually brings a really good flavor to your egg, so you don't have to put the chili or the ketchup and everything that goes along with it.
Wait a minute. Is this like a real thing?
This is for real.
All right. Absolutely. Okay. Well, no wonder I didn't recognize it, but go ahead. All right. How do we do it?
Okay. We actually start off with eggs. Obviously, we have some
there
eggs
you go.
Here.
So perfect, because we have some here. Nice.
We do. And I actually want to see you crack an egg
well,
without
I can
the
crack
egg.
An egg.
We need egg white. We
oh,
need
without
egg
the
white.
Thing? Oh, hold
exactly.
the, hold
Let's
the
see
thing.
How skilled you are with your hands, Gary.
I have no idea. Without the... Oh, that's going to be...
Without the yolk. Without the yolk.
Okay, that one's failed.
He already messed up.
There's Norm
Ballinger. He already messed up.
All right, we'll try again. I don't know if I can do
without the yolk,
this.
Gary. Oop. Up. Nope.
Wait a minute. How am I doing?
Keep it going. You're getting a little bit in there, but a little bit's okay.
Oh, my God. That reminds me. Okay. Does anybody have a tissue? No, I'm kidding. Oh, nasty. How'd I do? See, look at that.
Oh, you did okay. You did all right.
Bad.
Let's give him a round of applause
yeah,
for
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
that
yeah,
is
yeah,
really
yeah.
good, Gary.
Yeah.
That means
yeah.
he's good with his hands. That means he's really good.
Stop with that. My God, you're worse than I am. All right, there
okey
we go. Dokey. Now what do we do?
And we actually just whip it up. You know, the more
we
whip we get to it.
Say exactly.
There we go.
Note to self, budget for towel.
No, do not give him napkins. Let him be dirty with his hands.
Oh,
okie dokie.
The crew is all over you. Here, I'll hold this while you do the thing. All right.
Of the trade here.
It is.
You do whip up the egg white. You do definitely want to whip it up pretty well when you have all the little bubbles in it.
So this is eggs mollet.
There you go.
Nice. Egg very nice. Mollet. All right.
And as you can tell, I'm doing this here. And what you're going to do is you're going to put it on a 350 skillet that is nonstick. And here we go. I'm going to go ahead and put it on
all right,
skillet.
Go ahead. Like, we haven't seen eggs cook before. This is unbelievable. What do we think you are, all idiots or what? Really? Look at that. No, it's an egg and it's going down the thing.
Egg down the hole. That is not a good sign.
So it's
that
egg in the hole.
Not a good sign. Exactly. Egg in the hole.
Egg in the hole. All right. Are we?
It's called the mollet. Oh, okay, everything will pass, but you know what? There you go. There's your egg white.
What? What is
doesn't
this?
It doesn't matter here.
No,
it's
I know. It doesn't.
Healthy.
That is great looking, isn't it?
It is great looking. It really is.
My God.
You know, when you look at it, it looks like a hot mess. Just like me.
Like me again with
exactly.
the hot mess.
Hot
Fine.
Mess.
All right, hurry up. We gotta let's see.
Here we go. Let's wrap this up, and obviously I have pre-cut tomatoes and cilantro and onion, and you just basically want to go ahead and spread all that on there. And the more you put on, the more you cover it up, you know, like makeup, you know, it'll start looking really, really good. I promise.
Okay.
Yeah. The more color, the prettier it is, right? Right, ladies?
No question about it. No question about it.
Exactly. And when it looks pretty, they eat it. Guys are suckers for something beautiful. And you just let it simmer there.
All right.
Let it simmer.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm actually not a cook. I am pretending today. I am acting. Sorry.
I hate to tell you this. I think we were all picking up on that, but go ahead.
Okay. And what you want to do is you just want to scrape it up almost like a crepe. and you want to go.
What did you call me? No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Charming,
yeah,
hot.
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, that's
beautiful.
The one. All right, you know what?
There we go. And you just want to go ahead and fold it over like that.
All right.
Like a crepe. See how nice and pretty it looks there? See that?
Good and enough. That? All right, very good. That's close enough to food for us. You know what I'm saying? Beautiful. Nicely done. All right, we're going to get out of here, and when we come back, Brian Simpson will take the stage and do some real good stuff up here, all right?
Yeah. Stick